Thank you both, Dr. Magda and Dr. Pinsky, for this outstanding brain stimulant lectures. You really, I think I've been looking for of my older resident in the room listening to this, because we always face it as clinician when they call us in the middle of the night, how far we should go with our vasopressor. So from a clinical point of view, I want your opinion. In a normotensive patient and in a hypertensive patient, how far we should push the pressors?
What's the first thing? How high should we push the in the hypotensive?
When they're
personally, I struggle
shocked.
With that. I actually, as you might have guessed, because I always seem to be a little different, I actually don't use the mean in most patients. I actually like the systolic. I find one of the problems with the mean is that if you have somebody who has a low diastolic pressure, then the mean is low, and I'm not sure what that means. Now, I don't know if I'm right. I always make sure that it's a real systolic. I make sure the tracing isn't blunted, and I would usually get a cuff pressure, and that's my gold standard. But that having been said, my targets, I would agree with being 90 systolic or around 65, but you can't in some patients, was your question. You get that call, and the pressure is like 85 systolic, and the mean is 55, and you can't. I don't know what the answer is. In that article I wrote, my first paragraph, I said, I'm not going to tell you the answer. This is how I would do the study, and I think we have to do the studies. Now, I was impressed, Michael, that you showed a bunch of those saying 50 for a lot of organs was okay, so it sort of supports that argument. I'll just make one quick point. I think, as you nicely showed, the kidney is going to take a hit. So the question, how important is it to try to save the kidney, and are we damaging the rest of the body, and or should we just give up on it? I don't know the answer to that. I think we need studies to answer that.
Well, in the hypotensive patient, I disagree with Shelley. If I want to know if the patient's lost vasomotor tone, the best way to assess that is the diastolic arterial pressure. Because if I have a decrease in arterial tone, the diastolic pressure can get very low. And I can have an adequate cardiac output, so my pulse pressure will be very high. My mean arterial pressure will be low a bit, but the diastolic will be low. If I have a low cardiac output as the cause, as in severe heart failure, I'll have a low pulse pressure, but the diastolic pressure is actually quite high. And you see the pressure going like this and then going straight for a while. And so the diastolic fall off is a measure of the baseline tone and is the one thing I expect to see change if the norepinephrine is working. The other way to look at it is, why are you giving norepinephrine in the first place? What is the pathophysiology that's causing the loss of vasomotor tone? And to a large extent, it has to do with mediators and the hyporesponsiveness of the vascular endothelium to its normal adrenergic response. In a septic shock patient, they have increased catecholamines in the blood, not decreased. Before you start, they've already got more than you do. If you took purified blood from them with all the toxins of their blood out, but everything else there, and infused it in you, you would become hypertensive. Okay. So what we have is a hyporesponsiveness. And so in my management, I start with norepinephrine. The only indication for dopamine is hypotension associated with bradycardia. Okay. So for me, I give norepinephrine, and if that doesn't work and I'm pushing up to 20 mics per kilogram per minute, then I believe Jim Russell and I start vasopressin. But I start at 0.5 mics per kilogram per minute and don't change it, because I'm giving it as a hormone replacement to improve the adrenergic receptor. But one of the other things that Larry Wood asked me many years ago when I showed our first work showing that there was a generalized vasodilation across all vascular beds in septic shock, his response to me is, then why are you worried about hypotension? Yeah, why are you worried about hypotension? If every vascular bed is dilated, just increase cardiac output, and with the hypotension, you'll have an adequate flow to the organs. Now, you'll excessively perfuse some organs, but no one will be in trouble. And the answer is, you simply don't know that's true, and we do have evidence of end-organ hypoperfusion. Furthermore, the kidney will always take a hit, not only because of the pressure-flow relationship, but because it has two arterial circuits in series, the efferent and the afferent arteriole. And when you have those in series, you're going to cause profound hypofiltration through the glomerulus. And that's going to cause renal failure.
Well, you really hit the right question. Yes, the diastolic is down, but probably when it's down, I suspect a lot of it is that critical closing pressure. And the question is where and what. The key thing is, in the muscle, one of the problems in severe sepsis, I think the muscle dilates, which becomes a real problem on a number of levels. It partly contributes to the rise in output, but it's a waste of flow. Now, there's also an important difference on where alpha receptors act. So years ago, my favorite study, but it's a really complicated one, we were studying the effective baroreceptors on the distribution of, compensating for the drop in pressure. And one of the striking things, it's not our data initially, but we showed the same thing, is when you activate the baroreceptors, you vasoconstrict your peripheral bed, presumably through sympathetic tone, more than you do your splanchnic bed, which makes a sense from an evolutionary point of view. You want to protect those vital organs. But that creates an interesting shift of fluid back to the central compartment, which actually can decrease cardiac output through complex means. But it also says to me that when we give norepinephrine, I would not expect that you're going to get an equal constriction in all departments. Now, I think at moderate doses, maybe it's more physiological, and you're still, I agree, you already have a high tone, and you're going to do it. But at higher doses, I don't know what you're doing. So actually, Michael and I completely agree on this one and our patterns, interestingly. So I do exactly what he does. When I get to 20, I switch to I add vasopressin. I don't have any evidence for it. I don't think the VAST study tells us. They did actually better at the lower ones than the higher. But that's what I do because I still think it works. I really follow the lactate, and I follow the cardiac output a lot. So cardiac output becomes a very important guide. So I guess that Larry Wood message got to me. I like to know that that's going in the right direction. And if the lactate's coming down, I'm happy. But I've gotten to the point where I've stopped going to some of those ridiculously high doses. When I get to about 50 or so of norepinephrine, I'm just not sure what it's doing. And I've started not going that high. Have I caused harm or not? I don't know. I had a recent heart transplant patient who I ran with a systolic pressure of around 75 to 80 systolic for over 24 hours because I couldn't get it higher. I just gave up. And he recovered and did better. And I ran him at that level. Yeah, he lost his kidneys and had to dialyze him for a while. But he actually recovered. I just couldn't. And I thought if I went higher, I was making him worse. Just going back to the diastolic, one of my favorite experiences with a good friend of ours and well-known to many people, Didier Payen, who worked with us for a few years, and he was obsessed with diastolic pressure. And when I found when I took over with him, I would just do norepinephrine weaning rounds. I was just taking everybody off the norepinephrine. I found he was way off. I didn't find I was killing people when I took it off. So I am not convinced that you need to chase the diastolic pressure. He did the experiment for me.
Well, you probably had shown that they no longer needed it. When you give a patient who is hypotensive a vasopressor, you're making a philosophical statement. You are stating that you know better than the patient's body what you want to have to the vasomotor tone of the individual organs, because all the organs will vasoconstrict in proportion to their adrenergic responsiveness. And yes, we do. And the point is that when you have a person who is getting better on vasopressors and you wean them off, you actually see their organ perfusions increasing because they no longer needed the high level of vasopressors. So I do what Shelley does as well. When I come on service, the first thing I try to do is go down on the PEEP, go down on the norepinephrine. And almost invariably on every patient I can, which doesn't mean that they were not doing the right thing before, but it means that people get afraid when they go up on these vasopressors and they think they need to hold them there. And the answer is you have no idea. If I've got you on a level of a vasopressor, the body will relate to that and it'll maintain its tone accordingly, even if it's getting healthier, and you don't know you don't need it until you start to take it away. But anyway, that's an interesting question. We could talk about this forever, but I saw that there's another question in the audience.
I just want to go through that. I was nodding at first when you said, I forgot exactly where you said it, but I had a different interpretation. A good example is phenylephrine. So people frequently give phenylephrine. The studies in the literature show that you almost never increase cardiac output, with a few exceptions, pregnant woman being one of them, maybe, an alpha blocker, if you have spinal shock. But what you do at that first stage, when you're giving that small amount, you are hoping that the autoregulation, the brain and the heart, are going to say, I'm more metabolically active, and although you've constricted, I'm going to fight that, and I will do that. And that probably will occur at moderate levels. So if you're at the 8, 12, 15 level of Levofed, I think those organs can distinguish. It's as you're going up, then you're affected, begin to affect everything. Where's that break? I don't know. And maybe that's what vasopressin is doing. It's letting you come down and letting those other factors come in.
Back there. I'm sorry, she raised her hand, she took it down. I guess not. Sorry.
If you notice, I guess the big answer to your question, you notice what I put first was antibiotics, get things going, source control. Without that, it's tough.
If you don't treat sepsis, the source of sepsis, I don't care what you give in terms of the volume, it won't matter. You have to give antibiotics and source control, period. If you don't do that, they're dead. Now, we never talked about the concept of whether you should be giving sodium chloride or a balanced salt solution. Oh, and he said he wasn't going to do that. But I think that the we do know that chloride causes renal vasoconstriction. And so potentially that has a detrimental effect. The proper study has not been done. There is one being done now prospectively in Australia to look and see if normal saline, which is 0.9 normal versus a balanced salt solution, would be useful. But I just wanted to give you a historical note. Does anyone know why we use normal saline? Well, when Ringers and the various Uyghurs and those various people were creating fluids to infuse into animals, they made a Ringers lactate solution, which had they used Ringers solution, and they had multiple electrolytes in it. During World War II, they found that it was just too expensive. But if they just took 9 grams of salt, sodium chloride, salt, sterilized water, dropped it in it, that it would work just as well. And so they said, it's cheaper, it's faster, that's what we're going to do. And that's what an entire generation of trauma surgeons learned in World War II, was that 0.9 normal saline, because it was created by a company in Cleveland to do that. There was never a study that showed it was useful. And afterwards, the argument was that it was cheaper than other forms. Today, in Kuwait and anywhere else, the balanced salt solutions and normal saline are the same cost. And there's very little indication. There are specific indications, but there are very few indications to use the hypertonic, chloride excessive normal saline in your patients, and I almost never use it.
Yes, essentially, we've brought up the subject. I'll just comment. I think if you're dealing with 2-3 liters of fluid, my own bias, I don't know the answer, I think is the amount of chloride, not necessarily the concentration you get, because there's that whole intracellular compartment. So if you're in the two, I think that's what we learned from the split study, that smaller amounts probably don't matter. If you're giving 5-6 liters, I think that chloride load could become important because it clearly produces a hyperkalemic acidosis. It's important to know that and not react because it's just what you gave. And then I will usually switch solutions or to something at that point if the chloride's rising.